you know, I should have a corporation which requires less labor, which is lean, and which is producing a lot of profit. You know, in the Germans, it was a lean and hungry. We want lean and hungry corporations, hungry for profit and lean in terms of employment. This is a famous German expression. This is what would be the management dictum. Standard, but the management dictum is for a firm. Suppose all firms, this is the example I was giving you, suppose all firms try to increase their, or succeed in increasing their productivity. What will happen? Income rises, you say?
I said excess supply.
There will be excess supply. And there will be no market to sell. So very soon they will know that this cannot be done and they will come back again to the employment. You know. So it will be what originally, without having a theory and so on, but Adam Smith being a genius, at first thought they don't teach it in American universities, but Adam Smith was the first one to have pointed out that the division of labor, which was his main argument, the division of labor is limited by the size of the market. Division of labor basically means, I mean, there's a famous quotation from Adam Smith I use very often, that division of labor basically means the how you increase your labor productivity. How much you can increase your labor productivity is limited by the size of the market. Okay. Now, so if you have this, you know, thing that I have to actually do it in the export market, I have to prove myself in the export market, you will never get out of this trap, employment trap. And actually, the more and more the whole world seems to be getting into it. I mean, we have to be competitive. Each one has to be competitive. Each one competes with another one. Everybody uses more and more mechanization. And that thing comes on employment. How does it come on employment? And how do you do it? You see, you have two problems which get intermixed and which changes their relationship in the process. You say to, if I have to enter the market, I have to mechanize and so on, which I have already said. But if I cannot succeed by mechanizing, I have to give inducement to our corporations to do all these things, you know, to compete more successfully and so on. How would they compete more successfully? You read it in the newspaper, but you don't see it in this way. You read it every day in the newspaper. You do it in two ways, and which both the previous government, that is the last, the United Progressive Alliance, the UPA, and now the NDA, they both had this in common, and the CPM, and the Samajwadi Party, or wherever you are from, or from the in the south, in the Jayalalitha, they all fall in the same scheme of doing how do you incentivize corporations. You incentivize corporations in two different ways. One is, you see, earlier you give them subsidies, you give roughly the same amount of subsidies to corporations as you give to the all the poor together in India. You give to the all the subsidies, more or less, both are of the 2,000 lakh crores approximately on an average over the last 15 years. Now, this is the traditional story. The traditional story is also the fact that you know you have various kinds of labor disabilities, that and so on, wage discipline and so on. Things started changing when you realized that they had to give incentives to the corporations to compete internationally. You can do two other things. You have two other weapons in the government's armory which are not used. And what are they? As I said, you did it every day. One is you give them cheap natural resources. You know, that I will give you cheap land, I will give you cheap forest, I will give you cheap mountains, I will give you cheap coastline, jungle, Jal Jangal Jameen, as they used to say. I will give you all these things relatively cheap, and you produce it cheap and sell abroad, so that you become a success story abroad. Right? This was one element which the other element was, we would not be too strict about your loans. So long as you invest and you know do something, we will be rather relatively free with loans, and hence 10% of India's what you call non-performing assets, bank loans and so on, because you simply say that you know we will give to the corporation. I'm leaving out all this corruption, so on and so forth. I mean, you know, those are minor matters. Look at the broader picture, the actual picture. The actual picture, these are minor aberrations in the whole thing. Even if you had a government which is not corrupt, you would have the same. Because these are policies. These are policies which are really, which require the corporations to do. This you must understand. That, you know, corruption, we hear so much about it. That there is corruption in terms of individuals taking the money and pocketing it, and there is policy corruption in the sense that the policies which really goes against the people, like what I'm showing, that you allow loans to be taken from mostly from nationalized banks on a very simple terms, which is now close to 10% of our GDP. Second, you allow natural resources to be easily handed over to the corporations, which is again a small part. And you want them to compete. Now, it does not seem to produce the kind of results. I mean, leave out Vijay Mallya, who is a special, rather extreme case. But even otherwise, it does not seem to produce very good results. Why? The reason why it does not produce very good results is there is also a very simple commonsensical explanation. And which actually they should tell you in a management school, that if you are a manager and if tomorrow you have the choice of deciding, you know, should I improve my factory, should I improve my, you know, whatever it is, workplace and so on, in such a way that I am better able to compete, train my workers, which are all long, relatively long-term difficult things to do. Or should I somehow create a good public relations with the government so that I can get some land? So that I don't make profit, and this is where things become quite different from Marxism. You do not make profit anymore. And you know, when I hear all this leftist talk also, you know, I find, you know, not only they are in another world, but it is also completely, they seem to be blind to what is going on. Because actually what you see is, think of yourself as a, you know, corporate manager at a very high level. And if by some method, if you can convince that you deserve this land, you deserve this coastline, you deserve this political patronage, everything apart, because it is a part of government policy, you deserve this, then you will get a wealth transfer which is very easily equal to the maximum profit which you can make in 10 to 15 years together. As simple as that. I have actually done some very, very tough calculations. So, what does it mean? That I would much rather spend on public relations trying to convince the government that these are the things which is to be done. Hence you get, I mean, originally it was started by, this was called the business model of Dhirubhai Ambani. But now it has far advanced with people like, you know, Adani, everybody, Tatas are there. Everybody tries to get, if you travel in India, if you travel outside big cities, you will see this. I mean, you know that you take over land, you take over forests, you take over and you give it to these people. You see it in POSCO, you see it in so many places. You take over these things, and if you give it to the corporations, you hope the corporations would make use of it. But in the process, you change the what is called the business model of the corporations. The business models of the corporations now become that how to get this wealth transfer done rather than make profit by exploiting workers. It has a paradoxical opposite side to it. The opposite side to it is the trade unions. You see, traditional trade unions are also at a loss. Because for traditional trade unions, it is workers on the shop floor versus the management, where the fight is, where the class struggle is, blah, blah. Okay. Now, the fight has actually shifted to the countryside. It is a countryside from where all these natural resources have been taken. That is where actually the problem is coming. I mean, today in Rajasthan, you have peasants who have never thought of politics, who have never talked of politics. They know that it is their livelihood. They're not going to go away. You know. Everywhere, you know, you go to Chhattisgarh, you will see the same thing happening to the land in tribal areas. That it has very little to do with politics, it has much more to do with their livelihood. They cannot give this up and go away, because this becomes their problem. Traditional corporations, the management, I mean the corporate houses, as well as the labor, they actually think that they are still carrying out the so-called class struggle between labor and capital in the, on the shop floor, on the factory. I mean, there is exploitation, there is all that. I'm not saying that this doesn't happen. I went to Maruti to see what is happening a couple of times, talk to the workers. What they say is not untrue. It is extremely difficult working conditions, so on and so forth. Some of their grudges are very, you know, how they are squeezed in terms of hours of work. All this is true. But even if you maximum squeeze the Maruti workers, you will not make the profit which you will make if you can get, like they are now getting, Adani is now getting the whole coast, the big coastline in Kerala. You know. You see, this is where things have completely changed. And this is where if you think of it in terms of its employment, by transferring resources, you do not particularly create jobs. You create some jobs. Some sociologists have done work, including somebody from Berkeley, I know, that when this land is transferred, a new class is created of local lawyers who sort of, you know, help in the process, the patwaris and so on, who are able to speak to the patwaris, give them a little bit of money here, there, and so on, and get the things smooth. There's a new class of lawyers, you don't see them in Delhi and so on. But this is not creating employment. I mean, I'm not talking morally, but how many jobs, you know, compared to the jobs which you destroy by taking your livelihoods, by taking your coastlines. And this is where, you see, I think the basic problem is not where you create employment. How do you create more employment? But the basic problem, one of the things it must be today, is I do not have time, I do not want to speak much more. But you cannot destroy people's livelihood. I repeat, I'm not talking morally. But I think basically, if you really want to keep the unemployment problem, the poverty problem within limits in India, given the constraint on, that we, how much we can sell and so on. The only way to do it is to define the speed of your industrialization, the speed of your growth in terms of keeping livelihood intact, number one. Second, as much as possible in this world, shifting the emphasis to the domestic market where smaller firms, smaller producers are able to compete more, able to produce more, and create employment. Thank you.